Jnaneshwari. Some of you all. So the question is very, very straightforward. Arjun asks that, am I eligible for all this? So as I told you, for when people come to our classes, they take our interview to see if we are eligible to teach them. Which is fine, right? Because everyone wants to go to the good yoga teacher. The yoga teacher should know. So the student feels that I am fit, but is the teacher fit to teach me? So they interview the teacher, and that is how all this starts. Over here, Arjun is asking his teacher that, am I eligible? I want to know what it is. Will you tell me? And this is what he says.
Maybe what page, please?
Page number 603. Actually, we should keep out a few Jnaneshwaris from the next lecture, please. Yes? Mm-hmm. Yeah, they are in that cover. So, he keeps talking about how can I do it, how is it possible, how can I control, how can I walk towards Pratyahar, because all this has been told. When Krishna has told about Samarpaya Yoga Uchyate and Karma Sukaushalam in the second chapter, we go back to the second chapter because there is one of the most important definitions of yoga, and that is in Jnaneshwari, where he says that the mind and the intellect, they unite. Okay? When the mind surrenders to the intellect, it is yoga. Now this is very much theory. I cannot explain to you. Theory cannot be explained. So we are just reading the concepts, allowing the concepts to flow, and maybe our journey will start towards that. So we will have to go back to chapter 2. Chapter 2, Shlok 50. And in that, there is a very beautiful conversation, and that conversation gets us here to chapter 6. So if you come back to 197, page 197, those who already have the book. So after the 50th shloka, he says, he defines yoga, karma, kaushalam. It is so, these are three words, but we have to understand what is karma, and what we have to understand what is skillfulness. Skillfulness in what? In getting efficient in doing the actions, what is it? And for that, we have to study the third chapter, the fourth chapter, the fifth chapter. So it is the beginning of an entire thought process. So we are not getting into that. For us, the skillfulness right now remains in doing our trikonasana properly, finding the space in the pelvic girdle, finding the space in the groin. That is the skillfulness. But I do not want you all to get stuck in that skillfulness. I want you all to help to use asanas as a stepping stone to go towards further awareness which does surface from the body. So when you are going to get that freedom from the tightness in the pelvic girdle, it will help you to sit down calmly at least in swastikasana for 10 minutes. When you sit down calmly in swastikasana for 10 minutes, there can be some contemplation and reflection. Otherwise, it's not going to happen. So we are going very much hand in hand in asanas and pranayams that we are following, and then see how this theory can come into us. So there is the OV which comes after the 50th shloka. It is 273. And it is a very, very important booklet. Please, some of you should buy this if you all want to study with me. Especially the ladies' classes where I am asking you all, you all should buy this. Jnaneshwari, we have a few copies. And over here is the most important, that when it merges, when the mind and the intellect merge. Now that definition we have not put anywhere over here. We have not put. But that is how. How is it going to happen? What is the intellect? What is the mind? Where is the mind? And how can I completely dissolve my or surrender my mind to the intellect? And that is where we have to go back to the sixth. So because that was not written, I got your awareness on the second chapter. So now coming back to the 6th chapter, where we are talking about Arjuna asking that, am I eligible to do this yoga? How is this yoga done? And then he starts telling. Okay, I'm going to just read out. It is shloka number 16. Who all are eligible to do this yoga? And what is it that you have to keep in mind? So it is Arjun, yoga is not meant for the person who eats a lot or who eats too little. Yoga is also not for him who sleeps too much or does not sleep at all and tries to remain awake all the time. Extremes. So making decisions like, okay, I'm not going to eat this, I'm not going to do this. Somewhere for Swadhyaya, the Swadhyaya component has to come in your approach towards the principles of Yama and Niyama. So the Tapas Swadhyaya Ishwar Pranidhan of Patanjali's Yoga Sutras, of the Sadhana Bhar, and the 10 principles of Ashtanga Yoga, which come in Yama and Niyama, have to have the whole approach. They are interconnected. Everything is a lot interconnected. And when you understand that interconnectedness, you can start having this control. So first and foremost requisition is you can't eat a lot, you can't sleep a lot, you can't talk a lot. Okay? Then he goes, then he explains what in Nanishwar he's explained further. So why shouldn't you? What happens when you're, we saw organs of perception. That is why I've covered organs of perception before. What if my tongue has too much of its taste? My eyes are always hungry. My ears always want to listen to different things. My skin has to always feel different textures, different feelings. So, if that condition does, when will that condition come? It will come with withdrawal, pratyahar. When will that condition come of pratyahar? Again with your discipline. It is also not for anybody who suppresses his hunger and thirst or starves himself forcefully. So he goes on explaining. Then in the 17th shloka, he says, whose food intake and behavior are moderate, recreation and other activities are regulated, whose sleeping and waking patterns are balanced, for him, yoga destroys all the sorrows and sufferings. So easy, right? We have to just be moderate. He didn't say don't enjoy. He said enjoy. Recreation is there. It has to be moderate. Now here is our question. How do you do this? What do we do? How do we get that moderateness? How do we get the balance? So at least sometime, somewhere, I can sit down and I can sit quietly for 5-10 minutes and contemplate. Think about what is accessible to me, how I can go towards that condition. I have not said which condition. I have still not said anything about what is the condition that you have to achieve. Because we are still not there. I am just preparing the outer preparation, what is required to walk towards the path.